Greetings, and thank you for tuning in to Augustina Frazier Ministries, where the word of the Lord is a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your pathway. I am so delighted to be before you on today, and I'm excited about the word that God has given me. I pray that your week has been blessed. It has been a beautiful day, and I pray that you were able to get out and enjoy the weather. Well, let's get to the word of God today. Like I say in my sermons, normally it's between 15 to 30 minutes, and I believe it's going to be around that time. So anyways, the word of the Lord today is coming from Genesis chapter 18, verse 10, and Genesis chapter 21, verses 1 through 3. And it reads, chapter 18 of Genesis, verse 10, it reads, "And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah heard it in the tent, which was behind him." This is a powerful word on today. I was praying and asking and seeking the Lord this week, what would you have me to minister today? God didn't give me anything specifically, but I did hear him say to me by Wednesday, it's in your hand. In so many words, whatever you feel need to minister to the people of God about, you minister that. So the Lord has been dealing with me about Genesis 18, verse 10. And it's about Sarah, Abraham, and Sarah. But I'm also going to read chapter 21, verses 1 through 3. And then we're going to come back to 18. And it reads, this is the birth of Isaac. "And the Lord visits Sarah as he has said, according to chapter 18, verse 10. Now we just read that. "And the Lord did unto Sarah as he has spoken." And I'm going to tell you what he said to her. "For Sarah conceived and bared Abraham a son in his old age, at the set time of which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son that was born unto him, whom Sarah bare to him, Isaac." Father, in Jesus' name, we come on behalf to preach your word. We ask that your word be a lamp unto thy feet and a light unto thy pathway. We ask that you allow me to decrease as you increase. Lord, have your way. Have your way in this word on today. And I ask that you bless every living soul under the sound of my voice. Be pricked in their heart today. Let answers be answered today. Let confirmations be confirmed in their spirit. And may their spirit be uplifted and encouraged. We thank you for this opportunity to preach your word. I am so grateful, Lord, that you have chosen me in this season to minister your word. Thank you for grooming me and preparing me throughout these years. But I thank you for the appointed time. So, Lord, we bless you and we praise you. Now we ask that your anointing come down heavy. Let your dunamis power come. For you said you sent your word to heal us of all of our diseases. And diseases is not always physical. Sometimes it's just frustration, whatever this may be. But Father, we command these blessings. We thank you, and we thank you, in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen. So I'm going to go back to 18. And 18 was dealing with a visitation that Abraham received from two messengers from God. Literally, they were angels. That's what they were. They were angels. But God sent him two messengers. Hallelujah. But before I go there, I'm going to talk about, God sent him two messengers. And really what the messengers was coming to tell him is what God had confirmed in his spirit in chapter 17 about a birth that was coming to him and his wife. And it was factuating and it was mind-boggling because Abraham and Sarah was in an older age and proper literature or proper the definition for seniors when they get older, they call it older seniors or older adults. That's right. I'm sorry. Not older senior, but older adults. And that's those that's in their 70s and 80s and 90s, even maybe this 80, 90s, because you know how it is. 80s is the 70. But Abraham and Sarah at this time in chapter 18, they were 80, Sarah was 89 and Abraham was 99. And listen, they received a prophecy from God. This is before the angels came, the two angels came, but they had received a word from God that Sarah, God was going to allow Abraham to impregnate her at an older age. And it was fascinating. We will look at that today in this day and age, century 21, 2021, as a miracle. And I'm believing that around the countries. I remember about maybe 10 years ago, I happened to be watching the news, and I don't know which country this was, but I remember this older adult. She was in her 70s. She was 70 or plus. I don't know what country it was. She was a Caucasian lady. She had brought forth a child. I can't remember what sex it was, but the child was healthy. So I'm not saying that that's happening now, but this was about 10 years ago. But literally that happened in our world today, that this woman was 70 plus years old and she brought forth a son. And the reason why I say that, at the age that Sarah was, 89, she was barren. There was nothing moving. I mean, she's past all the stages that women go through, all the different dynamics of hormonal situations or development or however you want to classify. I'm not a GYN. But she had went through all the stages that a woman go through. And really, she was just at the barren time, meaning older age, just enjoying her senior years. But God said, no, I have a seed that I'm going to plant in your spirit through your husband. Your husband going to go into you. That's the way the communication was in the Old Testament. It would say that he went into her, meaning he went into her intercourse and they brought forth a child. But this was what going on, and I'm going to talk about it because I thought it was so powerful and it was so factuating. God literally woke me up one morning, and this has been about 2 weeks, and I was getting ready. I usually get up for prayer anyways between 4 and 5 in the morning, and sometimes it's a little earlier. God had just awakened me. I have an awakening, and I'm wide awake, and I know that's time to pray. You just got to know how God deals with you. Some people get other ways that God communicates with, but he just takes my sleep away and I'm wide awake and I know what my assignment is because God will deal with me. But anyways, I'm going to go back. Before I go back to Genesis 12, because I want to just talk about a couple of scriptures leading up to 18 and up to chapter 20, 21. And I told you tonight I will not be before you long. But I was looking at another scripture. When God says it's your season, it's your time, because that's what the sermon is. I'm sorry. It's time. It's called It's Time. God brought to me today when I was studying Ecclesiastes 3:1. To everything, there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. That's why I said there's nothing new under the sun, because usually what a person experienced, it has happened. Even if it was centuries ago, it happened. But Solomon wrote Ecclesiastic, and he was a man of wisdom. And he said, there's everything, there is a season. And we're in a season. We're getting ready to shift into this. We're in the spring season. So we're shifting into a new season anyways. And he said, it's a time and a purpose under the heavens. And that's what God told me. He said, this is a purpose season, meaning you have been through the different dynamics to get to the stage of a purpose. Because sometimes you know you're supposed to do something or give something or write something or prepare for something, but you don't have the purpose. But God gave Abraham and Sarah a purpose, and that was to bring forth their son. Now, this was unbelievable, and I know some things that people are experiencing today. It looks impossible, but the Bible said, through God, all things are possible. And you see, you can go back and read this, and I encourage you to start with Genesis 12, because that's where I'm going to start, all the way up to 21st. It is a powerful a story about these two awesome people, but you can read further after 21. And it talks about the miraculous thing of God. And it talks about the key thing, God's promise. And it talks about it's a season and time and purpose under the sun, under the heavens, for everything. And everybody has their season, time, and purpose. That's the key words out of Ecclesiastes 3:1. Season, time, and purpose. Oh, hallelujah. And I know that you've been having a purpose, but maybe didn't know when to go or what to do with it. But this is the season and time for your purpose. And that is what God was saying to us through this word. I know when you preach the word, you can come many ways with this, but this is what the Lord gave me, and this is what God is honoring on tonight. I'm so grateful that he said it's in your hands. Whatever you see fit the people need, give it to them. So when God gave this to me, I tell you, I was getting ready for prayer, and the Lord dropped Abraham and Sarah in my spirit. And he gave me specifically. And so I went and I researched the scripture about 5 in the morning. And verse 10 stuck out like a sore thumb. And when I read verse 10, just like I read to you, the anointing was on that page. And I said, the Lord was saying, it is time. It is time. Hallelujah. So I'm going to read verse 10 again. And then I'm going to go back and read a couple verses. Verse 10 in chapter 18 of Genesis says, and he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah, thy wife, shall have a son. So he was saying here, I have told you this before, but now I'm reminding you that I'm going to do just what I said. Now, they have heard this from God in chapter 17. And I don't know the time frame between chapter 17 to 18, but then God sent the angels, two of them, to remind them, to remind Abraham, I told you this a while ago. Well, it's the time for it to come to pass. And so that's why I said the sermon is called It's Time. It's Time. So anyway, that verse is dealing with Sarah laughed at a promise. And God wants you to know today, don't forget he know what promise he made you. I don't care what it is. I'm in this season right now where God is having me emphasize his promises and his will to you. He got me in this mode, and it's a fantastic mode. Because not only is helping you, but out of my mouth, it goes back into my earlobes, down into my spirit, and it's ministering to me as I'm ministering to you. And when I finish with the ministry, I sit before God for just a moment so I can kind of just process everything. And the same word is going back in my spirit to keep my spirit uplifted too. So I thank the Lord for his word, because his word is anointed and is sent forth. The word is sent forth and it returns back not to him void. That means it goes out and accomplish everything that God sent it out for. So believe God on today, because I'm in this season of teaching and prophecies of the things that God has given you. And he just don't want you to give up. He don't want you to think he forgotten about you. You need this alone time. You need this alone time. I hear some of you say, man, I've been alone for a while. I've been in an isolated mode. You think it's an isolated mode, but it's just time for you and God. During this pandemic and this COVID situation, it has put everybody into like a little alone time. And it's just time for God to deal with you. I know in our state, Michigan, everything is opening back up, but people are slowly getting back to somewhat of the new normal. Because I said, I don't think we ever will have the same normal, but the new normal. And I know it's been challenging, but these times it's been designed for you and God. These times been designed for God to communicate back with you and talk to your very soul. I know we all been seeking the Lord, because he said his altar been filled with the voices of his people pleading with him and talking to him. Everything is not always crying. What God was referring to me is that a lot of people are thanking him and praising him. And I know I've been right along with you. I've been touching the green with you. Hallelujah. I've been thanking him for just getting us to another year, another month. We're in our third month, going into our fourth month, and God has been good to us. So I'm going to talk about this. I'm going to go back. I just reiterate before I go to chapter 12. One of the commentators said about verses 1, Ecclesiastes verses chapter 3, verse 1. He said, there is a season. He said, a certain time, a season mean a certain time appointed by God for its being and continuous, which no human wisdom or providence can alter. So my question to you, what season are you in? What season are you in? Are you understanding the season that you're in? And if you're not understanding the season that you're in, you need to read Genesis chapter 18, verse 10, and Genesis 21, verse 1 through 3, but read 19 and 20, and it'll help you understand the season. You also should go back to chapter 17 and look at what God himself told Abraham. God himself told Abraham, and then God sent a confirmation in chapter 18 to let him know this is true. I always think about Gideon. Gideon, he asked God to give him two confirmations. This was a Gideon's confirmation, a call to the work that God was giving him. And Gideon wanted God to confirm it. So Gideon said, well, if this is of you, oh God, that's showing me this and telling me this is what I'm supposed to do, allow the ground to be dry and let the fleece be wet. He got up the next day and it was just that. And then he said, well, Lord, I need one more confirmation. If this is of you, again, let the fleece be wet and the ground dry. So I ask you, if you're still trying to understand everything that God is telling you, ask God to give you confirmation. It's not a bad thing. I ask God all the time, just like I was praying to him all week. What do I give your people? What do I say to your people? For it's not about me, but it's about God. So I'm going to drop down to chapter 12 of Genesis, verse 1. It read, I'm just giving you a little history, and I'm not going to give you a lot, but just a little. I think you hear where I'm going with this, because I feel the anointing. But I do want you to know, it's time. It's time. That's all I heard God. At least he did give me the subject. It's time. And you'll understand more. Chapter 12, this was the call of Abram at the time. He wasn't Abraham. His name changed was a little further down in chapter 17. But this is what God told him. He said, Abram, now the Lord has said to Abram, get thee out of the country and from thy kindred, from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. So here God was dealing with Abraham. Well, I'm going to say Abraham, because he was with his father, and God was calling Abraham out. He was calling him. Call means I'm giving you something to do. I'm giving you assignment. I'm giving you responsibility. Hallelujah. And so God was telling him, it's time for you to leave from under your father and your kindred and go. I'm calling you to another country. And so verse 2 said in chapter 12, and I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Did you hear what God said? He said, before I go a little further in verse 1, did you make the change that God said? Did God tell you exactly what to do, and have you done it yet? That's what God wanted me to say out of that verse. Have you made the change? Have you departed like you should? Sometimes it's not a physical departure. Sometimes it's here in your heart. Have you gotten away from the things? Have you let go of the things that God told you to let go? It was a scripture that came that the Lord gave me this week, and I can't think about it. He said, lay aside every weight and sin that so easily beset thee. I think that's in Hebrew, because the Lord dropped that in my heart as part of the sermon. I apologize. I don't have it with me, but I know it's in the book of Hebrews. And I think it's chapter 12, verse 1, I'm guessing. So pardon me. But he told him to lay aside every weight and sin that so easily beset you, meaning things that's causing you to deter from God. And sin is not always what people define it for. Sometimes sin is just simply disobedience. Obedient. If he told you to do something, or if he told you to let go of something, or if he told you to break habits, or if he told you to clean up your house, get a lot of things out of your house and donate it, give it to people that need it. If he told you it's time for you to make a job change, if he told you to retire, he has other things for you to do, and God will give you time to get things together. And see, in chapter 12, God was preparing him for what was coming up in chapter 18 and chapter 21, because he needed him to get from under his father and get out of the same old so that he can do what he needed to do. And he told him, he said, once you do it, I am going to make your name great. Hallelujah. No, he said, I'm going to make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and I will make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And that's what you want to be. You want to be a blessing to people. Verse 3, excuse me. And I will bless them that bless you, and I will curse them that curse thee, and in thee shall all thy family of the earth be blessed. Now, you know God has something special for you to do. Maybe you're supposed to retire and trust him. You got all your ducks in a row. I'm sure you've been working on it. But he said he got more work for you to do. Now you got to remember, I think around this time, Abraham was in his 70s, somewhere 75, I'm guessing. And pardon me if I'm guessing wrong, but I believe it is 75. I had it in my notes, but I don't have it in these notes. But he was around that age. And God, that's past retirement age. But God told him, your work is not done. I need you to do this. I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to make your name great. And I'm going to bless, you're going to be blessing people. And I'm going to bless families because of you. Hallelujah. In the mighty name of Jesus. So the Bible said, Abraham departed just as the Lord spoken. And he took Sarah and his family and Lot. And I'm going to move a little further. I'm going to jump to 13. And read verse 3. And it says, "In after he parted his ways," it said verse 3 of chapter 13 of Abraham, of Genesis. It says, "And he went on his journey from the south even to the Bethel unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning." So in so many words, I'm not going to go into that. Abraham did do what God said, and he left from under his father. And the first key thing is obedience. Did you make the change that God said? Now, he told you in the beginning of chapter 12, of verse 1, he's going to do something for you. And sometimes it's about, you know, sowing in many different areas. And I told you before, it's not always money, but money is the answer to all things. So, you know, money helps us to get forward. Money helps us to do things. But God was telling him he wanted him to physically move in faith and trust God. So have you moved in faith and trust God? Have you made the changes? I know some people are saying, I don't really know what to tell the person because I'm moving on. I don't know what to tell my kids because I'm moving on or whatever it is. But you got to ask God for specifics because God gave Abraham specific direction. I'm not reading all of chapter 12 to you. I'm not reading all chapter 13 to you, but I encourage you to go back and read it all because see, this is what the Lord told me. I'm going to do these in your life, Augustina, because you have been prepared. You labored, you stay faithful to your kin folks, you stay faithful to your leadership in spite of anything that had went on, even when you disagreed, but you stay faithful. You stayed in situations when you felt like you were under oppression, but you made it through it because it was making God, it was developing more of God's character in me. It was developing more business ethics in me, business leadership in me, and all the things that God has promised me. So I don't complain about what I went through because I know it was designed by God for me to go to. So I'm going to jump down to 16 of chapter 13. 16 says to God said to Abraham, "Arise, walk through the land in the length of it and in the breadth of it, for I will give it unto you." So God was telling Abraham, I'm going to give you this land. He already told him that he was going to make him a great nation, which is exceedingly far above how we can think. But God was testing his faith, and God said for me to say to you, have your faith been tested? Is that what you've been going before God and talking to him about it? He wants you to know that your faith is supposed to be tested. This is all about faith. He said, if you have faith of a grain of a mustard seed, he would do what he has said he would do for you. So Abraham did that. Abraham stepped out in faith and he trusted God and he did just what the Lord said. So let me tell you something. I read the wrong verse. It's verse 16. I read 17. Let me read verse 16 in chapter 13 of Genesis. Because I said it did sound a little different. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, my goodness, if the man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. So he was telling Abraham, and I want you, and I was going to tell you, study about the seed, but I'm not going to go there. Because I was studying the seed before I started the sermon, but I said, I don't want to start something new and put too much information. But God told him that I'm going to make thy seed as the dust of the earth. Imagine the dust particles. It's trillions of dust particles. That shows you how big God was making this man. That shows you how big he was making his family. That shows you how great this man was going to be, because he was going to be a what? A blessing to the land, a blessing to family, a blessing to the earth. So I'm hearing God say, have you made the changes? Have you moved forward in God? And I told you, everything is not physical, because I had to learn that the hard way. When God would tell me to move forward, I'm thinking to actually move physically. But God was saying, it's in your heart and mind first. I first got to work with the inner man before the outer man can react to what I'm saying. So God is saying to you, do you trust him? Have you made the changes, he said? Do you know that your faith of a grain of the mustard seed gonna make you whole? God told Abraham in verse 16 of chapter 13 of Genesis, he said, I'm gonna bless the seed as the dust of the earth. Just think about dust. If I get a little dust in my home, sometimes I'm doing my dusting on the weekend, it builds up on my little tables and stuff. Just a little bit on a piece of a paper towel or cloth that I use, there's thousands of particles, and that's just a little patch. But he said the dust of the earth. So just think what God was doing for this man's life. God was letting him know, this is bigger than whatever you can think. And that's what God is saying to you. This was this next move in this season that you're in now, he said, it's bigger than what you can ever imagine. You said you wanted to bless people. Well, this is a season you're going to bless people. Remember, the subject is, it's time. So I'm going to jump down to 17. Chapter 17. I told you, I'm just going to give you a little bit. It's for you to read behind me and bless you. So this is where God made Abraham name change. See, there's a change in you. You're trying to respond to the old person, but God said he made the change because of what you did, because of the obedience. And man, listen here. Everybody's looking for the outward appearance. And I learned that through when I was preaching about David a couple weeks ago, when David was anointed a king. God told Solomon that man look at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. And God been looking at your heart. He said he's seen the changes that you made with your heart. And if you made the change in your heart, that means you changed the way you've been thinking. And God said he's been pleased in how you made the change. And for those that have not made the change, God said he love you. If you just make the change here in your heart, you got to first start with forgiveness. You got to let that bitterness go. I was just looking at scriptures about bitterness. He said, God was showing me, Augustina, I've been working on the inside of people. Hallelujah. That's why I let this season of isolation, that isolation was time between you and God. You thought you was by yourself. God said his spirit is in all places. Hallelujah. He's been there dwelling with you the whole time, because he's been making inner changes in you so that the glory of God of what he did for you manifests on the outside, just like it did for Abraham and Sarah. I'm almost finished. But have you been allowing God to make the changes in your life? Have you allowed him to make those changes in your heart? You got to forgive and let go of things. He told one of my sermons a couple weeks ago, he told them to blot it out. Blot out what happened. Hallelujah. You're the only one that can do that. God will guide you and lead you, but you got to put the work there. You can't keep living in the past. You can't live what people have done or what you have gone through. That is a testimony. That stuff that you went through is a testimony. Lift up the name of Jesus so people know that God can do anything. But it's not for you to live in the past, to be hurting and disappointed and discouraged and depressed. That is not God. Hallelujah. That is not God. He said he wants you to blot it out, meaning get all the pain out of it. Just have the memory so that you can testify and give God the glory and bless people. So when you're sharing it, what God has brought you through, I don't care what it is, it would be medicine in people's soul instead of burdenness in people. And God was showing me, and I hear him saying, that is why people are forsaking you. That's why people are pulling away from you, because people can sense that you have not let some things go. And this is a season to be healed. This is a season to be free. This is a season that God is lifting the oppression off the oppressors, off those that's in oppressive state. So I want you to be free. I want you to go back and listen to the sermon that I preached about Paul, when he was in prison and God lifted oppression off of him. Hallelujah. So anyways, it says here in chapter 17, and I'm feeling the anointing, there was a name change in verse 1 and verse 15. Verse 1 was talking about the name change for Abraham because God had made him into the man of God that he wanted him to be. So he made a name change. So quit responding to the old way because your name has changed. The glory of God is upon you and people see the glory. That's why they're looking at you and say, wait a minute, he's talking the old way, but I see a difference in him. She's talking the old way, but I see a difference in her. So God said, come up to the level that he has brought you. He has given you standards. He has given you integrity. He has given you dignity. Hallelujah. He has blotted out your sins. He has blotted out your lifestyle. I know you've been hurt. I know you've been lied on. But don't you know in 1 Kings, I think it's 1 Kings, God said he was going to let a lion spirit come upon out of the mouth of the prophet. So God allows some things just to see how you're going to handle it. He said, pray for those that despitefully use you. I know you're saying you've been used. Hallelujah. You could talk to many people that has served God and they'll tell you, I've been used and mistreated, but I've forgiven them because God said, pray for those that despitefully use you. So pray for them. Don't tear them down, God said. God said that was a making of a great man of God. That was a making of a great woman of God. That's what God was using it for. God said, blot that out and get moving because he told you to leave from out that country, leave from out that situation, get out of that frame of mind. Let go of that hatred. Let go of that bitterness. Let go of dislike. Hallelujah. God said, let it go and make the change. Like he told Abraham in chapter 12, then you would see the results. Then you would get the name change. He already gave you the name change. You'll be ready to come up to the level that he has given you. And so verse 15 talks about the name change for Sarah. So I'm going to drop down to verse 19. Hallelujah. I'm going to read it. Verse 19 says, and God said, Sarah, thy wife shall bear thee a son. Indeed, thou shalt call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant. Who can tell you an everlasting covenant but God? And with his seed after him. Verse 16 and 17 of chapter 17 said, and I will bless her and give thee a son also of her. Yea, I will bless her, and she shall be a mother to the nations. Kings of a people shall be of her. Hallelujah. And then it says, verse 17, then Abraham fell upon his face, because you know he was up in age. By then he probably was in his 80s, oh God said. And he laughed and he said in his heart, shall a child be born unto him that is 100 years old? That's what God was telling him. And shall Sarah that is 90 years old bear? They wasn't that age yet, but they were getting close to it. They didn't become that age until chapter 21. But God was forewarning them that this miracle and this new covenant is coming to you. And so God was preparing him. So has God been preparing you? Has God showed you something? Has God spoke a word to you? He speaks his word through his word of God. Have you been praying? Have you been studying the word of God so God can give you direction? You keep saying to God, I don't have clear direction. I don't hear like I should. But see, God said, if you're not studying to show yourself approved, and if you're not attending to hear the word of God that the man of God and the woman of God is preaching, then of course you're not going to have direction. God don't do everything for you. I was told that as a young girl in holiness at 18, the pastor said to me, Augustina, you got to do your part. God doesn't do everything. So have you been studying the word of God? Remember, the theme of this ministry is the word of God is a lamp. Word of God is a lamp unto your feet and a light into your pathway. Then you'll be able to see what way to go. Then you won't pray amiss. You won't go amiss. You won't do your own thing. You will hear what thus said the Lord. So this is what God is saying today. Study to show yourself a proof of God. So I'm going to move on because my time is getting away from me. So then I'm going to jump to verse 18, back to 10. And I want to talk about this verse. It was a time that Abraham was 99 years old. And Sarah was 89, and God was ministering to them. And God was sending him a confirmation. You know why God sent him a confirmation? Because it said he fell flat on his face and he began to laugh out. I'm of age, God. I don't even think I could produce, God. That's what Abraham was saying. And my wife cannot produce, oh God. But God told him this covenant was coming and that she was going to bring forth a great son. Hallelujah. That's going to be an everlasting covenant. So God brought forth, sent two messengers. Hallelujah, two angels to visit him. And they were standing outside under the tree that Abraham usually go to. And Abraham saw them afar off and he walked up to them. And I'm going to read just a little bit of it. And it said that the Lord appeared unto Abraham. Let me go to verse two. And he lifted up his eyes and he looked. And lo, there were three men stood by him, three. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself towards the ground. Now, this is chapter 18. I'm reading verse 2. The Lord appeared unto him in verse 1. I'm on verse 3. And he said, my Lord, if now I have found favor in thy sight, pass not away, I pray. I pray thee from thy servant, let a little water, I pray you, be fetched and wash your feet and rest yourself under the tree. Now he's talking to the angels, and I will fetch a morsel of bread and comfort ye your hearts. After that, ye shall pass on, for therefore are ye come to your servant. And they said, so do as thou hast said. Abraham hastened into the tent. Unto the tent unto Sarah and said, make ready quickly 3 measures of fine meal, kneel it, make cakes upon the earth. And that was bread. And Abraham ran unto the herd and fetched a cattle tender and good and gave it unto the young men after the Bible said he used milk and butter. And he gave it unto the young men and they hastened to dress it. And he took butter and milk. And a calf, which he dressed and set it before them and stood by them under the tree, and they did eat. Now, these are angels. And then it went a little further. I'm just reading it because I think it's very good for your soul. And then it says in verse 9, this is where Sarah laughed at the promise again. And was what Abraham laughed in chapter 17, but Sarah. And they said unto him, where is Sarah thy wife? And he said, behold, in the tent. And he said, this is where the Lord anointing fell on the scripture. Verse 10 of 18. And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. Lo, Sarah, thy wife shall have a son. Now the time of life means, when you look in the Amplified Bible and under commentator, it meant the time of life mean they was going to return within 1 year. Because this prophecy of this child, she was going to bring forth a child. So the time of life means that the number of months it's going to take for her to have this child, carry this child, and birth it. They were telling Abraham, I'm going to come back or I'm going to be present to confirm because this is going to happen. So then this is what God gave me. God spoke to me out of this one verse. That's why I'm sharing it with you. Because he gave me a prophecy a year ago at this time when he gave it to me a couple weeks ago. And he said, I'm going to come back within 1 year what I've spoken because it's going to come to pass. Hallelujah. So when God gave that to me, I didn't forget, but I had put it in my subconscious mind. And he was reminding me, I gave you a prophecy in January of last year around this time. And I told you that it's going to come to pass. So God was telling me in this verse 10 of chapter 18 to remind you, whatever he told you, it's going to come to pass. That's why the subject is called It's Time. Now, God gave me the subject. He allowed me to pick the verse. And I know it's a blessing to your soul because I feel his anointing. So when God said that to Sarah, it said then, and Sarah heard it in the tent, which behind him. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old, well stricken in age. And it ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of a woman, meaning she wasn't able to do the things of a woman would do. Therefore, Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I am waxed old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord, being old also? She was talking about being the intimacy not the just touching, but the intimacy of intercourse. And the Lord said to Abraham, wherefore did Sarah laugh? Now this is God. Tell me God don't hear everything. Did Sarah laugh? And shall I of certainty bear a child which I am old? Is anything too hard for God? God told me to ask you, is anything too hard for him? If he said that he was going to do this, he said, is anything too hard? Is anything too hard? So then at this is verses 14. At the time appointed, this is what God said. At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. Then Sarah denied, saying, I laugh not, for she was afraid because of what God said. And he said, nay, but thou didst. So God said, even your thoughts, he know what you're thinking. That blew my mind. I tell you, I had a spirit-filled time, because God was showing me, even though I knew this, but it's a reminder. We got to watch our thoughts, because when God gives us something, we may not say it here, but we're thinking it. And if you're thinking something, the Bible said, what a man thinketh, so shall he be. So if you're thinking doubt, it's not going to happen. It's going to delay it. And so that's what God was saying to Sarah. Oh, not this time, because your husband laughed at the other time. But now you're going to laugh. And sometimes laugh, I learned with people, sometimes people laugh because they're nervous. And Sarah did get nervous. So God was showing them, in spite of what you're thinking, I'm still going to bring my promise to pass in the mighty name of Jesus. So I call verse 10 of 18, the birthing season begin. That's what God told me to tell you. The birthing season had begun for you in chapter 18. And birthing means the action or process of giving birth. And that is Ecclesiastes 3:2, a time to born. That's what was happening to Sarah. God had already touched her womb to get everything in order. So when her husband became intimate with her, he was able to produce the seed in her that God had promised. So I wrote by chapter 18, verse 10 of Genesis. It's birthing season. Birthing season has started for you when you first say yes to God. And birthing means it's an action, and things was in process. So let me tell you what 99 meant in the Bible, because that's the age that Abraham was. 99 meant in the Bible means sealed. Hallelujah. Seal means it was shut, closed, and finished. God has sealed that promise. So I teach my children, I taught them this at a young age, and I got this from the book of Revelation. You should seal everything in Jesus' name. When God gives you something, you should seal it in Jesus' name, meaning it's finished. And it would manifest at the point in time that God said, I love you for what you're doing. So I'm at closing, because I'm over my time by 10 minutes. I'm going to read chapter 21, verses 1 through 3. And I'm here. And it reads, the birth of Isaac. So God appointed time came to pass. And the Lord visits Sarah. I told you, God said he's going to visit you as he has said. And the Lord did unto Sarah as he has spoken. For Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age, and at the set time of which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son that was born unto him, whom Sarah bare, his name was Isaac. And that's the end of that. You can read it for yourself. And I'm going to close, because what the Lord told me to call verses 1 through 3, chapter 21, born. You done birthed what God has said. The birthing process has been going on for a while. And I know sometimes it gets weird. I think about a woman when she goes through the actual birthing process. I went through it because I had two sons. And it is a tedious process. And actually, I was the type of woman, I was small frame, so I had a very difficult time carrying a child. I was hospitalized the first, bed rest the first 3 months of my first child. I had morning sickness horribly. Then I had to be in a hospital a good portion of my first child. The second child, I had a difficult time carrying my second child. I had to be bedridden again. I mean, I just went through. So every birthing experience is not always wonderful, but it's wonderful to bring, allow God to allow you to bring a human being into this life, and you can love that person to pieces. I love my sons to pieces. But I'm going to close. Chapter 21, verses 1 through 3, God said you birthed it. And born means birth. It means existing as a result of birthing. You birth what God has said. It means having a natural ability to do or participate now in a job or a task. So when you born something, when something's birthed, you have the ability now to bring forth whatever this was, whatever the job it is, whatever task, whatever it is. You need to ask God, now what do I do with it? It also means perfectly suited to train to do some particular job when you born something, when you birth something, meaning you have a task now, you have accountability. And that's what happens when I got my sons. I had a large amount of responsibility. I had to change my whole way of thinking and living because I had these two beautiful, handsome sons that I had to raise from birth on. I had to train them, I had to do everything. But I do want to say this. Isaac's name means he laughs or will laugh. And I also want to say this to you. Abraham was 100 years old, and 100 in the Bible means God election, meaning chosen. Many are called, but few are chosen. I went over my time, so I'm going to stop here. I just want to thank you for tuning in this evening. It is a blessing to present this word, and the word of the Lord is going to be a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your pathway. I know some of you are struggling with some things, and some are not. Some just looking for answers. You get your answers through the word of God. You get your answers by praying and fasting, and I challenge you to trust God. Remember to go back to chapter 12, read all the way up to 21, and read further on to see the miraculous things that God is doing for you. But God said, you made it through your birthing season. You made it, and it's time. I am delighted about verse 10. God had to remind me that prophecy that I gave you in 1999 wasn't a fluke. That prophecy that I sent the man of God, don't know him. He just spoke the word, but I know of him because I know he's been a powerful speaker for many years, but I don't know of him. And he spoke it and he confirmed, and God had to remind me, now it's coming to pass. So I pray for you, and I ask if you would like to send a prayer request. You can send it to Augustina at Augustina Frazier Ministry. You also can go to my website, pardon me, because my web lady is working on it. It's going to be fascinated. You can go to the YouTube and leave a comment. And if you would like to sow into the ministry, sow, because this is going to allow this ministry to go further and reach many souls and also nation. I'm believing God for what he's shown me. I'm thankful on today. I bless you and thank you for tuning in. You take care and God bless you.